Hello fellow programmers, on this occasion I want to show you some further enhancements to the VST plugin host program I've been working on lately, and of which I have already published some videos. First, a quick recap of what has been accomplished until now. We saw how to connect to a plugin and display some of its particulars, like so. Then we wrote code to open the plugin editor's window. This is called an editor because it allows you to change some of the plugin's settings. There aren't many settings here for this Yamaha plugin to play with, but this is only a tiny tip of the iceberg, as there are hundreds of parameters one can manipulate via MIDI messages from a computer program, as we will see soon. Some plugins display a lot more controls in their editor window, such as Roland's Sound Canvas plugin. Then we have the option to connect an external MIDI keyboard and play music that way, or to use the computer keyboard, or this little on-screen keyboard, which is only there to quickly try out sounds. Sounds or instruments are selected from these drop-down list boxes. We have 16 MIDI channels at our disposal and can layer any number of sounds on top of each other. This is a very useful feature because to get a really good or interesting sound, you often want to mix some voices together. For instance, a saxophone sound is more convincing if it is mixed with a breath sound. The difference is subtle. Perhaps it works in the subconscious. These radio buttons here let us switch between some MIDI formats. Notice how the list of sounds also changes as I switch between the tune modes. The names and MIDI codes are loaded from an XML file. In the previous video, I demonstrated the MIDI player function. I think it's pretty cool, although I don't yet have a pause button and seek buttons. Now let me present the new features. First I'll show you the user interface, and then we delve into the program code. As an aside, let me say that I appreciate very much when people subscribe to my channel. Those who watch my videos would know that I'm not begging for subscribers, but it does give me encouragement to keep on making videos if I see that there is interest for them. So, if you subscribed, I thank you. Okay, so we have some channel level controls, vibrato, envelope, and these here. And down here we can change settings to create various effects. More on this later. When you click on an edit button, a little window pops up and you can manipulate the controls. You dismiss the little window with a click of the right mouse button. The envelope controls work in a similar manner. The key range and the velocity range are useful when layering sounds. With this, we have come to a crossroads. I can no longer support different plugins. From now on, my program will be custom built for the Yamaha SYXG50 plugin. This is because the system exclusive messages I need to send are specific to Yamaha XG. Next is the pitch. It is possible to change the pitch of a sound either by semitone increments or by tiny amounts. By the way, you probably already noticed that the control being edited turns pink or purple, I don't know, and the values are incremented or decremented with the up and down arrow keys on the computer keyboard or with the mouse wheel. Okay, now I show you the code for these channel level controls and I will discuss the effects afterwards. It is perhaps no surprise that the little windows that pop up are implemented as pop-ups in WPF. For instance, here is the pop-up for the pitch controls. There are text boxes and sliders. There is no magic here, so let's move on. In the code behind, here are the event handlers. When the user clicks on the Edit button, the little window with the controls pops up. This is actually a toggle, as you can see. The pop-up is closed with the right mouse button. The pitch shift and pitch detune controls are almost the same, so let's just look at the event handlers for detune. The got focus and lost focus events just change the background color of the text boxes. The other two event handlers are more interesting. See, in the MIDI specification, it says that the values range from 0 to FF hexadecimal, but the display should show anything between -12.8 to +12.7. So in the code, some value conversion is being done. And then, instead of sending a MIDI message to the plugin right away, I call this changeParamValueFor method with the text box as its argument. There are a couple of things I wanted to do. One of them was to make my code somewhat generic so that all text box edits are handled in one place and in the same manner. The other thing is that I wanted to avoid sending lots of MIDI messages in close succession when the user held down an arrow key on the keyboard to increment or decrement a value. So I introduced a little bit of delay. Let us see how this works. In the changeParamValueFor method, I first check if the user is still pressing the arrow key or rolling the mouse wheel, and that is what this userEditInProgress variable is for. I also assign the text box, the sender, to a variable I will reference later. And then I start the timer. This is where a slight delay is introduced. If no user action takes place within that time span, then I declare the editing complete, and I can now move on to sending the MIDI message to the plugin. That takes place in the timer elapsed method. I identify the text box where the edit took place, and you can see how this code localizes all the text box edits in one method. Here is our pitch detune. And the MIDI system exclusive message is constructed and sent to the plugin. I made the MIDI SysX message class static. There was really no point in creating instances of this class. I'll show you how my implementation works. I have a list of identifiers. Each of these stand for a SYSX message. The actual messages are these here, declared as a static array of bytes. So when I want to send a SYSX message, I pass the message identifier to the send method together with the channel number and the parameter value. These two numbers are plugged into the appropriate prefabricated SYSX message and put into the message queue. The message queue and the program code responsible for passing the message over to the plugin was covered in earlier videos. Sliders, like these in the pitch envelope generator, also send MIDI SYSX messages when a value changes. But, unlike with the text boxes, I don't have a built-in delay for the sliders. Time to discuss the effects. There are three groups of effects: reverb, chorus, and what Yamaha calls variation. Within each group, there are many different types of effects. So far, I only implemented one reverb, one chorus, and two variations. Reverb and chorus are global effects, in the sense that they apply to all channels. However, on each channel, we can choose the extent to which the effect will influence the sound. For instance, the reverb is now set to 40, which is the default, and you probably won't notice it much, but if I boost it up, then I think you can hear it. Even more so if I increase the reverb time. Variation is somewhat different. Variation can be either global, like reverb and chorus, or alternatively, it can apply to a channel. The two modes are exclusive. You can have either this or the other, but not both. Also, in channel mode, you can assign a variation to one channel only. The Roland Sound Canvas plugin has the same restriction. I don't know if it is a coincidence or there is a consequential technical barrier to placing effects on several channels. You assign the variation effect to a channel here. Or if you want it to apply to all channels, then you tick this system checkbox. There are lots of settings to experiment with. Where did I find these? Well, in the XG format specification document, of course. Everything you need to know is there. The challenge is, how do you incorporate all those details into a program? This is a PDF file, and copying things like tables is not possible because you can't select individual columns. So I first converted it to a Word document. It was then easier to work with. I ended up creating an XML document where the data is structured in a certain way. At the top level, I have reverb, chorus, and variation. And also a long list of parameters. The parameters are kept separate from any effect types because the same parameter might be shared by several effects. They have attributes like minimum and maximum value and the displayed value, which is often different to the internal representation. Okay, I won't go into further details. You'd fall asleep if I did. Moving on, I declared a number of structs that map to the nodes in the XML document. And I have an effect class with methods that read in the data and construct an in-memory object database of sorts. This class also has methods to extract various bits of data from the database. When you look at the user interface, you might think that building a tab page like this, and potentially many more tab pages like this, with so many controls, would be a tedious task. And it would be, if I had to manually place every control on the tab page. But it is all done programmatically by a couple of functions. I'll show you how. Here we are, the effects section. The build effect tabs method builds the three tabs. And the build effect parameter controls method puts the controls on the tabs. The actions taken in the body of these methods is basically driven by the data in the database. The code looks busy, but remember, after it was written for the first tab page, any number of tab pages can be generated without further effort. Ah, here is something worthy of a closer look. When I move the slider, the value of the slider changes. The display value also changes. In order for that to work, I bound the text property of the text block to the value property of the slider. But that's not all, because slider values and display values are different. So a parameter value converter was also used. A slightly more challenging binding was between this system checkbox and the slider controls. Not all parameters are applicable when the variation is set to system level. So, in order to enable and disable the slider controls accordingly, I created another binding. This binding also uses a converter, a parameter enable converter. There are many more intricate details I could talk about, but I think it is time to wind up. I will put a link to this entire source code in the description. You are welcome to download it, chew on it, digest it, praise it or criticize it. Just be aware that this is not a complete, ready-to-be-released application. Not at all. This is very much a work in progress, a prototype, or a proof of concept. I hope that you will actually write your own application and view my program as one possible way of solving certain programming issues in relation to a VST plugin host application. To which I wish you success.